pray with me. Dear God, we once again come before you, asking, O God, for your strength, asking, O God, for your power. Lord, asking you to speak a word to your people, O God, as only you can. And Father, I pray even now that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart will be acceptable in your sight, O Lord God. You are my strength, you are my redeemer, and you are our soon coming King, and you are the glory and the lifter of our heads. We thank and praise you now. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. The book of Joshua that we just read in your hearing from the Old Testament fits into the historical books of the Bible that trace Israel's journey after they left Egypt. It gives us a picture of how well they obeyed the laws of God that had previously been given to them in the first five books of the Old Testament. But more importantly for us today, what I want to emphasize is Joshua's new relationship with the Lord. You know, and it's good to hear from other people what God wants and what God has done for them and how God speaks to them. And it is good to be covered by others. But it is a day to celebrate when we can hear from God ourselves. And this was Joshua's time. It was a new thing for Joshua to now be the leader. It was a new thing that he was able to hear God talk directly to him as he had done previously to Moses. It was a new thing that Joshua has gone from being Moses' aide to now being the one in charge. Sometimes it's hard for people who have been in a supporting role to take the lead. But we see this often in Scripture. What is a surprise to some is really just God's way of planning for the future for his people. Joshua had learned a lot from Moses, but not only that, Joshua had also served Moses faithfully and was one of the spies who believed God would take them to the land that was abundantly prosperous. It may have seemed like it was just talk, but when God tells us something is going to happen, if we can believe him and we can obey him, it will happen. Not just for other people, and not just for the people that we read about, but it will happen for us, because God is from everlasting to everlasting. And whatever God says he will do, he will indeed do. This is what was now expected of Joshua, to listen and obey. And I believe today that Joshua has a lot to teach us about new things, and the anxiety and fear that also comes with it. When we are used to doing things a certain way, new things seem to disturb our sense of equilibrium. It disturbs our peace because we feel more comfortable doing it the old way. Joshua was used to doing things the way that Moses instructed him to do them. He was also used to hearing Moses' voice and not hearing God directly. But Joshua is now going to soon discover that if he does not want to make the same mistakes that Moses made, he must listen to the voice of God for himself. Now Moses, as we know, had talked to God face to face. And from all accounts, it seemed that Moses was going to be the one to take the children into the promised land. In fact, he was the one who sent Joshua and Caleb to check out the land that God had promised them. And now here he is, not having Moses to lean on, and everything is now falling upon his shoulders. But the most important thing that Joshua will teach us is that whenever God calls to do anything, he also equips. God will not leave us to fend for ourselves. And I say thank God that he will not do that. So the Lord said to Joshua, Moses, my servant, is dead. He said, get ready to cross the Jordan River. And just as a personal note, I guess in a couple of months we are still journeying to Israel, and we'll be standing right at the Jordan River. And many times people get baptized in this river as something to remember. But crossing over was a new thing that they had talked about it for a long time. Joshua, for one, had heard about crossing over for at least the last 4 years. And now it is somewhat intimidating that the moment has finally come. It was not so bad for him to cross over, but he was told that he was to get ready to cross over, but not alone. He had to also get the people ready. They had to cross over with him. This must have terrified him. There were enemies of God that could put obstacles in his way. Do you remember when Moses had to leave the ancestors of these same people? That they made Moses so mad, grumbling, that Moses ended up disregarding the voice of God, and therefore he disobeyed God. Now Joshua had watched this whole scene in Numbers chapter 20 when the people started to grumble and complain, saying to Moses and Aaron his brother, "We have no water." And they quarreled and was in opposition to Moses. The Bible says that they said to Moses, "Why did you bring us, the Lord's community, into this desert that we and our livestock should die here? Why, Moses, did you bring us up out of Egypt to this terrible place? It has no rain, it has no figs, it has no grapevines, it has no pomegranates, and there is not even water to drink." Now, mind you, if any of you know anything about the Bible, you know that when they were in Egypt, things were terrible. How soon did they forget how terrible things were, and they thought now what Moses was doing for them was terrible? Sometimes we forget about the goodness of God, and we forget about how we prayed for God to take us out of situation, and then when he does, we grumble about that. But the thing about God is God always wants to take us forward, not backwards. So Moses and Aaron went and fell face down and prayed to the Lord. And the Lord told them exactly what to do. The Lord said to Moses, "Take the staff, and you and your brother Aaron gather the assembly together. Speak to that rock before their eyes, and it will pour out its water. You will bring water out of the rock for the community so they and their livestock can drink." Sounds good, right? We always go and we pray and we always do what the Lord says. But Numbers chapter 20, verses 9 through 11 records Moses' response. It says, "So Moses took the staff in the Lord's presence, just as he commanded him. He and Aaron gathered the assembly together in front of the rock. And Moses said to them, 'Listen, you rebels, must we bring you water out of this rock?' Then Moses raised his arm and struck the rock twice with his staff. Water gushed out, and the community and their livestock drank. Was that what the Lord said for him to do? No, I don't think so. The Lord was displeased with Moses' actions because he said to him, 'You did not trust in me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the Israelites. You will not bring this community into the land I give them.'" What Moses did that warranted such a severe penalty from the Lord was this. First of all, Moses disobeyed a direct command from God. God had commanded Moses to speak to the rock. You know, sometimes when God tells us things to do, it can just sound crazy. Speak to a rock, God? Are you serious? But God was serious. You know why? Because God wanted to show his power and his might to his leader in front of the people. So he said to them, "Moses, speak to the rock." You know, the other interesting thing is that Moses and Aaron went to God and asked God, "What am I to do about these people, right? These people are grumbling, they're complaining. Lord, what am I supposed to do?" Have you ever been in a situation where you went to God and you prayed and you said, "Lord, I am at my wit's end, I don't know what to do"? And the Lord told you what to do? increase.
Amen.
You ought to say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Secondly, so he told Moses to speak to the rock, not strike the rock. And then secondly, Moses then took the credit for bringing forth the water. Notice how in verse 10, I don't know if you caught this, he went to them and said, look, you rebels, must we bring forth water? He wasn't bringing forth anything. It was God that was going to bring forth the water. Blessed be, it was not Moses that was bringing forth the water. So we cannot take credit for what God does. We have to give God praise for what he does. And we have to thank God for intervening in our lives. So Moses took credit for the miracle himself instead of attributing it to God. And then thirdly, Moses committed this sin in front of all the Israelites. Such a public example of direct disobedience could not go unpunished. Moses speaking to the rock in Numbers 20 was to be a picture of prayer. Instead, Moses angrily struck the rock, and he was barred from entering the promised land. And that is a good lesson to us, that when God speaks to us and gives us direction, that we cannot let people make us mad enough that we forget all about what God wants. I am sure that Joshua did not want to make the same kind of mistake, but honestly, he did not know how the people would respond. God told Joshua to get ready and to get the people ready. It was their time. They would get ready to do something that they had never done before. Now, I thought about this when we were at the picnic and we played a game. And there were two teams. We had two teams and a beach ball. And we were told that we had to wear a blindfold. And the only way that we were going to be able to be successful in this game is that we had to listen to what our team was telling us to do. And so it's exactly what they told us to do. And so we had these lines on each side. They put a beach ball in the middle, two beach balls for each team in the middle. And every person that would step out with the blindfold on, you could not see anything. And they would tell us go straight. They would tell us when to turn right or when to turn left, when to turn around. And sometimes it was really funny because the beach ball would blow out of the area. So you may have been right in front of it, but it blew right out of your pathway. So you had to listen intently to what was being said to you. And sometimes a person was right there and they had to turn all the way around before they could pick the ball. It was a lot of fun, but it further taught another lesson, which I believe that we are hearing about today. This is what I believe God was saying to Joshua. Now let my voice lead you so that you can lead the people. Otherwise, you will take the blindfold off too soon before it is time. So he said to Joshua, be strong and courageous. Be strong and very courageous. Have I not commanded you to be strong? And most of us would say, well, God, how many times do you have to tell me, be strong and courageous? He said this three or four times in the same passage. When God repeats himself, it is because he knows that we are going to face difficult waters. And when we face those waters, he wants us to hear him say, be strong and courageous. God knew what he was asking Joshua to do could not be done in Joshua's own strength. And I think about this often because it does take courage to obey God. He said to Joshua, be careful. And another way of saying that is be intentional to obey all the law that my servant Moses gave you, even though he did not obey it all. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left. He says, the reason that I am giving you these detailed instructions is because I want you to be successful. Isn't that wonderful that God wants us to be successful? And that was all part of God's getting them ready. God does not ever want us to fail, but he always wants us to succeed. This was like what we might call a pep talk, but it was more than that. It was a talk of encouragement to know that things may not be easy, but just follow my voice and you will cross over successfully. The voice of God today is in his word. As we read God's word, we hear God's voice. And in your getting ready, he said, do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it. Chew on it. Rehearse it day and night, night and day, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. This is how you get ready. We get God's word in our mouths and we meditate on it day and night. We stand on the word of God. Otherwise, what we see and hear will terrify us to turn back. This worked for Joshua all those long years ago. And I believe that it'll work for us because Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Now, for Joshua, it was a physical river, but we all have our Jordans to cross. Your Jordan River can be anything that you are leaving to get to the other side, where all things are passing away and all things are becoming new. It could be personal or professional. It could be health-related. It could be getting through depression or deep grief or sorrow. Whatever your Jordan is, the good news is that God is with us. As he said to Joshua, as I was with Moses, so am I with you. So today I also think about the nine countrymen that we have here this morning that have to cross over their Jordan. They will not have a physical Jordan to cross, but they will have other things that will come up in their lives. And so the Jordan is symbolic even for them. And Chris leading them, they are about to enter new territory, where in the Apostle Paul's words, they will be new creatures. For he said, if anyone be in Christ, they are new. All things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. No, when we see them on Sunday morning, they will not look any different, but they are embarking on a journey to enter into a new relationship with God, like Joshua did. For at their baptism, they could not speak for themselves, but now they will enter into their own understanding and their own relationship with God, just as Joshua did. They will not be crossing over alone, though. They will also be asking mentors to cross over this Jordan with them. They will need moms, they will need dads, they will need uncles and aunts and their pastor and their church family to cross over this Jordan with them. You see, they may be tempted to quit or they may even be discouraged, and that's where community is so important. And they may feel at times that other things are more important. But just as God told Joshua, as I was with Moses, I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will give you strength, the Lord said. These are words of comfort when we are called to get ready to cross over our Jordan River. Be strong and very courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go, not just in church, not just at work, not just at home. But the Lord will be with us wherever we go. These are encouraging words to us today as we face the challenges that come our way, no matter what they are. Joshua has taught us that we never go it alone, though. God not only gives us his presence, but he gives us community. So I say to the parents, like Denise and Maddie and Ruth and Chris and Lisa and Charlie and Gail and Michelle Curtis and Bud and Carrie, John and Melissa, and Wendy and Al Robinson, that Jesus is our living water, and he is going before us to make our river crossings a success. When we hear and obey his voice, we can cross over our Jordans together. And I say, praise God for the strength that he gives us. Praise God for the encouragement that he gives us to know that whatever we do and whatever we face, we don't face it alone, but we face it with God and with the people of God. Amen? So we have crossed over every Jordan that anybody places in front of us, because God will indeed be the rough places smooth and the crooked places straight. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Father, we thank you, for you are good. We thank you, O God, that you are from everlasting to everlasting. We thank you, Lord, that there is no shadow of turning in you. And Lord, everything, God, that we face, all the challenges that we have before us, Lord, I ask you to be with us, God, and that we walk together as one community. Lord, with our compromise and with all of the events that we have coming up, Lord, every challenge, help us to meet it, oh God. Even in our finances, Lord, help us, oh God. We pray, Lord, and we thank you for it in the name of Jesus. Cover over us, oh God. And help us to see all that you have for us is nothing but a road to success. Lord, help us to travel your way, to hear your voice, to do as you have commanded. Oh, Father, we love and praise you this day. Lord, I pray if there's anyone today under the sound of my voice that does not know you, Lord, that have never asked you to come into their hearts to live on the inside of them, God, I pray today that this would be their time to ask you to take up residence on the inside of them. Lord, we do thank you this day. We praise you. We love, honor, and adore you. It is in Jesus' name that we all pray. Amen.